There are a number of different ways to calculate how high someone has jumped, depending on which equipment we use. But even then, within a certain type of equipment, with a force plate, we can use either the flight time method or the impulse momentum method. And in this video, we're going to compare the differences in these two methods and discuss which may be the best one for you to use with your force plate. I'm Joe Clubb, founder and sports scientist for Global Performance Insights, which provides sports science support to companies, sports teams, and practitioners all around the world. So when we're using a force plate, the jump height is defined as the vertical displacement of the center of mass. Now, let's do a quick recap of what a force time curve would look like with a counter movement jump on a force platform. With a counter movement jump, then we have hands on hips to just isolate the lower body capacities rather than bringing in any upper body, either strength or coordination factors. Now, this figure is thanks to VALD, who have sponsored this episode, as well as our whole series on athlete testing. You can take a look at the playlist that will take you to all the videos in this series. We have the athlete standing still on the force plate to start with, and the force at this time point will just represent their body mass. We initially see an unweighting phase and then this braking phase as the athlete is squatting down and accelerating towards the ground, and therefore they need to decelerate to brake to then change the direction of their center of mass to then propel themselves upwards through this triple extension movement in the counter movement jump. We see obviously force goes to zero at takeoff when the athlete is in the air before they then land back on the force platform. So for more information on these workings within a force platform, have a look at my video on how force plates work. But for now, we're going to get into two different methods of calculating jump height with this information from a force plate. First of all, we're going to look at the flight time method. So our flight time method calculates jump height based on how long an individual was in the air. So it's here that our takeoff time is calculated, identifying precisely the moment that athlete has left the force plate and the moment that they then land again. With an accurate flight time, then we input that into this equation for jump height. Flight time squared times by gravity, which is 9.81 meters per second squared, and all of that divided by 8. This is known as the projectile motion equation. And perhaps it's simpler initially to think about just throwing a ball into the air, because as soon as an object is in the air, the only thing acting upon that is gravity, which of course is constant. So all we need to determine the jump height then is the flight time. That then is how we calculate jump height from time in air. Now, there are some advantages and disadvantages of this method, which I'm going to talk about, but we're going to do that once we've looked at our impulse momentum method so that we can compare the two side by side. So moving on to our impulse momentum method, and this one can be seen as a little bit more complex. There's more physics involved. Essentially, with this method, we use data from prior to the takeoff to calculate the takeoff velocity. Because once we know the velocity that someone leaves the ground with, we understand the impact of the constant of gravity pulling the individual down, so then can calculate the jump height. Calculating the takeoff velocity itself is based on knowing a few things from this phase of the jump. Knowing accurately how much the jumper weighs, that they started perfectly still so we can identify where they start moving, and then how much downward force they applied from the start of that jump until their takeoff point. The important thing here is to understand impulse, and that is the integration of force over time. Another way to think about this is the area under the curve. So we need to calculate net impulse by initially calculating the force that is measured due purely to body weight. Any force above body weight is then multiplied by the time period that it occurs under to calculate the impulse, and essentially the size of that space under the curve is the same as the impulse that the individual applies during the takeoff period. So this figure is taken by an article in Aspetar Journal led by Matt Jordan, demonstrating how the impulse momentum relationship is used to determine takeoff velocity in the vertical jump. I want to give a massive shout out to Lucas Tormier, who is the product manager for ForceDecks, who helped me to hopefully translate this figure into a relatively simple explanation. So to find takeoff velocity, as long as the jumper is perfectly still when the rep begins, then their initial velocity is zero, and therefore their momentum is also zero. With that initial momentum being zero, then impulse and momentum for the jumper in the subsequent jump are the same thing. So once we know that, we can calculate the area under the force time curve that we measure with ForceDecks to find both impulse, as we talked about, and also momentum, because in that situation, impulse is equal to the change in momentum. We can then calculate velocity from momentum using the mass of the jumper that we measured at the beginning of the test in the quiet phase.
ForceDecks, the world's fastest, easiest, and most powerful dual force plate system. Assess physical performance in seconds. Jump, land, squat, push, pull, and more. ForceDecks automatically analyzes more than 20 common tests. You can even record video, which is automatically synced with your Force data. Then find all your data and records in one place. VALD Hub, including integrated norms based on millions of data points, helping give context to your athletes. And it's not just ForceDecks. You'll find all your VALD data in VALD Hub. One login, all of your performance data. Welcome to VALD.
Let's now illustrate these two methods with some real data. So I have exported around 800 different data points collected via VALD's ForceDecks from their hub for this example, so we can see how the jump height with these two calculations compare. So here with my export, then we have jump heights calculated using the flight time method, and we have jump heights calculated using the impulse momentum method. And looking at the averages of the two different methods, we can see that flight time does seem to overestimate in relation to impulse momentum. And that is a pattern that has been confirmed throughout the literature. We do get higher jump height values using the flight time method compared to the impulse momentum method. They are fairly well correlated. Research again shows around a 0.8, perhaps a 0.9 correlation between the two methods. We can see an R square value here in this data set of around 0.8. I thought this outlier obviously was interesting. I dived deeper into this as an example, and we are seeing here a jump height using the flight time method of 36.6 centimeters. With the impulse momentum method, we only get a jump height of around 10.4 centimeters. And as I suspected, this was due to very unstable quiet time prior to the jump. Put simply, the athlete was moving around a lot. So the system with the impulse momentum method was not able to get a good calculation, an accurate understanding of this individual's body mass. And I think this is a nice example then of how that impulse momentum method really does rely on getting a stable quiet period, because body mass itself is then involved in the calculation. Whereas, as we discussed, flight time is purely based on time in the air during the jump, so wouldn't be influenced by a poor calculation of body mass. So then you may be thinking, what does that mean? The flight time method should be preferred because it's not prone to these inaccuracies when body mass is not accurately measured. You remember, with jump height, in terms of calculating it from a force plate, we're defining it as this measurement of vertical displacement of center of mass. And therefore, the impulse momentum method appears to do that more accurately than the flight time method. Key limitation of the flight time method is that it assumes the same position on the way up as on the way down, on takeoff and in landing. And this is linked to the way that sometimes athletes try to cheat the system with jump tests by perhaps tucking their legs or flicking out their legs to extend that time in the air. So if you are going to use the flight time method, then it is critical to watch your athletes, to observe them, and to try and control the technique that they are using with each jump. In brief then, the flight time method provides a really quick, simple, consistent method for measuring jump height, but it's ultimately not as accurate. The impulse momentum method is more accurate for measuring jump height, but only if you can get a consistent and accurate body mass measured during that quiet phase. If that's something you can get in your setting, then you may want to use the impulse momentum method from the force plate to calculate jump height. If, however, there's going to be an issue with trying to get that accurate body mass, whether that's due to real time constraints or perhaps even language barriers with the athletes that you're testing, perhaps flight time may be more suitable for you. Crucially as well, then, we've seen that there is a strong but not a perfect correlation. So most importantly of all, do not use these two methods interchangeably. Pick one or the other, flight time or impulse momentum relationship, and stick with that because they are not a perfect relationship. I hope you found this video useful. If you did, please like and subscribe so you don't miss out on another video coming soon. Thanks again to VALD Performance for sponsoring both this video as well as all the videos in our athlete testing series. And of course, if there's a topic or a question that you'd like to see answered in our collaboration together, then please comment below or in the community tab on the Global Performance Insights channel page. And keep a lookout for another video coming very soon.